Grace, mercy, and peace be to you from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. The sermon text is Ezekiel 33, verse 1 to 11. The word of the Lord came to me. Son of man, speak to your people and say to them, if I bring the sword upon a land, and the people of the land take a man from among them, and make him their watchman, and if he sees the sword coming upon the land, and blows the trumpet and warns the people, then if anyone who hears the sound of the trumpet does not take warning, and the sword comes and takes him away, his blood shall be upon his own head. He heard the sound of the trumpet and did not take warning, his blood shall be upon himself. But if he had taken warning, he would have saved his life. But if the watchman sees the sword coming and does not blow the trumpet, so that the people are not warned, and the sword comes and takes any one of them, that person is taken away in his iniquity. But his blood I will require of the watchman's hand. So you, son of man, I have made a watchman for the house of Israel. Whenever you hear a word from my mouth, you shall give them warning from me. If I say to the wicked, O wicked one, you shall surely die, and you do not speak to warn the wicked to turn from his way, that wicked person shall die in his iniquity, but his blood I will require at your hand. But if you warn the wicked to turn from his way, and he does not turn from his way, that person shall die in his iniquity, but you will have delivered your soul. And you, son of man, say to the house of Israel, thus have you said, surely our transgressions and our sins are upon us, and we rot away because of them. How then can we live? Say to them, as I live, declares the Lord God, I have no pleasure in the death of the wicked, but that the wicked turn from his way and live. Turn back from your evil ways, for why will you die, O house of Israel? Amen. You may be seated. Jake Zabel has been called as pastor and is now publicly to be ordained today to the work of an under-shepherd under Christ. This is a day to look especially at the duties you are to fulfill as a pastor in God's church. Jake, you have been trained and examined so you can fulfill the duties of a pastor. You have been called to fulfill those duties and are given the mandate to exercise the rights that come with those duties. Your service should be judged by how you have fulfilled your duties. Therefore, we will look especially on the duties of a pastor. So what is expected by you as a pastor? Many will see a pastor mostly as a leader who is to figure out by himself how to effectively lead the sheep. Many think that you are mostly expected to generate growth in the church by your own strength. Others that your goal should be to not push people away from the church. To find out what your job is, we must look in God's word and not try to figure out ourselves what your duties are. And those duties are intimately connected with the power given to you as pastor. We read in the Augsburg Confession Article 28 about the power of bishops, which is the same as the power of pastors. But this is their opinion that the power of the keys, or the power of the bishops, according to the gospel, is a power or commandment of God to preach the gospel, to remit and retain sins, and to administer sacraments. For with this commandment Christ sends forth his apostles in John 20, 21. As my Father hath sent me, even so sent I you. Receive ye the Holy Ghost, whosoever sins ye remit, they are remitted unto them. And whosoever sins ye retain, they are retained. And Mark 16, 15, go and preach the gospel to every creature. So far the Augsburg Confession. The Apology 28, in the Apology 28 we read, and we are pleased with the ancient division of power into power of the order and power of jurisdiction. That is the administration of the sacraments and the exercise of spiritual jurisdiction. Therefore, the bishop has the power of the order. It is the ministry of the word and sacraments. He has also the power of jurisdiction, which is the authority to excommunicate those guilty of open crimes, and again to absolve them if they are converted and seek absolution. These are the powers of the authority of a pastor. Now, how is he to exercise those duties? We have been reading God's admonition to Ezekiel. We will see how it can be applied to the call to the ministry and the duties of this ministry. Ezekiel wrote, "The word of the Lord came to me, saying." At this point, Ezekiel had already been called as a prophet at this time, but was told, and he was told much the same thing as at his initial call. Now, the word of the Lord here should be interpreted as the pre-incarnate Son of God. The Lutheran Old Testament scholar Gishen has shown that the word of God in the Old Testament, when it comes to the prophet, is not just an abstraction, because it is coming and it is saying something to the prophet. Rather, it is the pre-incarnate word of God, the Son of God, whom we are told about in John's Gospel chapter 1, that the word of God is God himself and the Son of God. So Christ, the second person of the Trinity, came to the prophets before he was incarnate, and he spoke to them. He was the one calling them and sending them to preach. And Jesus was also the one sending the apostles, as we heard in the gospel lesson before, that he came to them and said, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, even so I am sending you." So Jesus is the one being sent from the Father, both as the Word in the Old Testament, but also as the Son of Man in the New Testament. And he is also the one sending the shepherds, the watchmen, both then and now. Luther says in his commentary to Galatians chapter 1 verse 1, "He called us all to the ministry of his word at this day, not immediately by himself, but by other means, that is to say, by man. But the apostles were called immediately of Christ himself, as the prophets in the Old Testament were called of God himself. Afterwards, the apostles called their disciples, as Paul called Timothy, Titus, etc. These men called bishops, and the bishops their successors down to our times, and so on to the end of the world. And this is a mediated call, since it is done by man, yet notwithstanding it is of God." So far, Luther. Ezekiel was to preach what he had heard from God immediately and warn those God told him to warn. Pastor Jake is to speak what he reads in the word of God and warn according to the word and what he can see, since he cannot know the hearts of men and is not a prophet. But aside from that, the prophetic office is the office of the word and the same office to which Jake is to be ordained. The warning to and from the watchman. So the word of God, the Son, warns both Ezekiel and the hearers of Ezekiel by this. Let us hear the same warning as a warning to the teachers and to the hearers in the church today. And let us hear it as a warning to Jake and the hearers of Jake in this congregation. First, God illustrates the point by a comparison with a watchman in a city, someone who is chosen to watch against the enemies attacking the city. God says, "Son of man, speak to your people and say to them, if I bring the sword upon a land and the people of the land take a man from among them and make him their watchman, and if he sees the sword coming upon the land and blows the trumpet and warns the people, then if anyone who hears the sound of the trumpet does not take warning, and the sword comes and takes him away, his blood shall be upon his own head. He heard the sound of the trumpet and did not take warning, his blood shall be upon himself. But if he had taken warning, he would have saved his life." So when speaking about worldly watchmen in cities, If they warn against the dangers, but people do not listen, then the watchman is without guilt. They cannot be accused because the people will not listen to the warning. Therefore, the blood is upon those who will not listen when the watchman has done his duty and warned against the dangers. Now, how does that apply to the spiritual watchman, the prophet, or the pastor? But if the watchman sees the sword coming and does not blow the trumpet so that the people are not warned, and the sword comes and takes any of them, that person is taken away in his iniquity. But his blood I will require at the watchman's hand. On the other hand, when the worldly watchman does not do what he is supposed to be doing, he is to be judged. If he does not warn the people he is supposed to watch, he will be judged, even in the world. Therefore, pastors will get a more severe judgment than others. How does it apply to the office of the word? So you, son of man, I have made a watchman for the house of Israel. It is God, not men, that makes someone a watchman in the church, the new Israel. While it might seem like the watchman is chosen like in the picture, just from the people, God is explaining here, it is a divine call from God. After the ascension, Christ is still the one sending ministers to his church. They are not just chosen by men, even when they are still called by God. Paul says in Ephesians 4:10 to 11, he who descended is the one who also ascended far above all the heavens, that he might fill all things. And he gave the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, the shepherds, and teachers. And those who have been called through men are said to be put in their office by the Holy Spirit, according to what Paul says in his sermon to the pastors in Ephesus. In Acts chapter 20, he says, pay careful attention to yourselves and to all the flock in which the Holy Spirit has made you overseers to care for the church of God, which he obtained with his own blood. You are an overseer, a watchman in the new Israel, and it is your duty to do the work of a watchman. God continues to Ezekiel and says, whenever you hear a word from my mouth, you shall give them warning from me. You're not like the prophets or the apostles to expect a direct revelation, a direct word of God that you are to tell. So you're not completely like Ezekiel or the apostles in this way. Rather, you are to study the words of the prophets and the apostles diligently in order to preach it correctly. So you are to study and to preach the word of God as it is written in the Holy Scriptures. You are to teach all the commandments of Christ as he says to the 11 apostles who were the first teachers in the church in Matthew 28. And Jesus came and said to them, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. And behold, I am with you always to the end of the age. Therefore, you are under obligation to preach and teach the whole counsel of God without leaving anything out, even if that part is not popular. God continues saying to Ezekiel, if I say to the wicked, O wicked one, you shall surely die, and you do not speak to warn the wicked to turn from his way, that wicked person shall die in his iniquity, but his blood I will require at your hand. You are to warn against sin by using the binding key, as Jesus says when he commits the keys to the apostles. If you withhold forgiveness from any, it is withheld. You have received authority to withhold forgiveness and bind the sins of those who will not repent of their sins. Now the reason and purpose of this authority is the one given by God to Ezekiel here, namely that the wicked should repent of their sins. So like Ezekiel is to warn the wicked according to direct revelation, you are to warn the wicked according to the word of God. This will not be easy. It is much easier to let the wicked continue in their sins and have peace on earth. You will be hated when you warn the wicked against their sins, so you will be tempted not to do it. The prophet Ezekiel could be tempted to not warn the Israelites of the sins that God commanded him to warn them against. That's why he's warning them. It would be much easier for Ezekiel to not warn the people. He would have more peace, worldly peace. You are also to warn against false teachers, wolves, as Paul says to the pastors in Ephesus in Acts 20. After having commanded the pastors to be overseers of the flock, he continues, I know that after my departure, fierce wolves will come in among you, not sparing the flock. And from among your own selves will arise men, speaking twisted things to draw away the disciples after them. Thus you are to warn and protect your flock against all false doctrines. If you do not warn them but let false doctrine into your flock, you are like a shepherd who lets the wolves eat his flock. You are instead to fight the wolves and even to die for the flock if necessary. This will also not be easy. It will be easier to make peace with false doctrine than to take a stance against it. Therefore, God's warning to Ezekiel also applies to you as to every pastor regarding false doctrine. If you do not warn the wicked against their sins or do not warn your flock against false doctrine, God will require their blood of your hands. But what if the people turn away from God's word, or even turn away from their pastor when he preaches God's word and warns? What if they do that, even when they are warned, and the false doctrine is condemned by you as pastor? God continues and explains this to Ezekiel and answers this question. But if you warn the wicked to turn from his way, and he does not turn from his way, that person shall die in his iniquity, but you will have delivered your soul. If you teach and preach correctly and you use the keys to warn the wicked, it is not your responsibility whether they will listen to you. If you have done what is expected by you, namely to warn when God's word warns, it is not your duty to make sure that people will follow God's word, or water it down so people will follow it. Therefore, Paul also says in his speech to the elders in Ephesus, before he says that they are overseers, he says, therefore I testify to you this day that I am innocent of the blood of all, for I did not shrink from declaring to you the whole counsel of God. And he might be referring to Ezekiel here, when he says that he is innocent of the blood of all. Paul, who had taught the whole counsel of God, was innocent of the blood of all, even if people would not listen to him. So you don't need to worry whether or not people will listen to you, whether or not your congregation will grow. It is no sign of your success. The sign of success as a pastor is that you teach and preach the whole counsel of God and use the keys to warn the wicked and the wolves. You are, however, not only to warn against sin and false doctrine. These are necessary in order to do the real job of a preacher. And this job is also described in God's word to Ezekiel. God continues and says, and you, son of man, say to the house of Israel, thus have you said, surely our transgressions and our sins are upon us, and we rot away because of them. How then can we live? The warning of the watchman should lead to contrition, to repentance. This contrition is recognizing sin and fearing the wrath of God, as Israel did here, when they confess their sins. It is enough when people feel the wrath of God. Contrition is not a good word that appeases God because of how deep felt it is. No, contrition is mere passive. It is God's alien work through his law when he crushes the self-righteousness of the sinner so he can probably receive the promise of forgiveness. Therefore, the prophet is immediately to continue and say, "Say to them, as I live, declares the Lord God, I have no pleasure in the death of the wicked, but that the wicked turn from his way and live. Turn back from your evil ways, for why will you die, O house of Israel?" So God doesn't want the wicked to die. God wants the wicked to repent of his sins and return to the Lord. And that is the proper work of God, that he saves sinners from temporal and eternal death. Therefore, God sent his Son, who took responsibility for the sins of mankind and became the Lamb of God that takes away the sins of the world. And having carried the debt of our sins, he died under the wrath of God. Because he had become man, he was able to die, because God can't die. But when God became man, he could. And because he was at the same time fully God, his death could atone for the sins of the whole human race. And because he had paid for the sins God had imputed to him, God also raised him again from the dead. So he is now the righteous one who has a righteousness that avails before God for the whole world. And because Christ is now righteous as our high priest and representative, he could, after his resurrection, also institute the loosening key, or the absolving key, is the authority to forgive sins, which Jesus gave to the first preachers after his resurrection, as we heard before. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. So we see here that sins are actually forgiven as an effect of the pastor's forgiveness. The pastor can forgive with authority from God, so that the pastor's earthly forgiveness causes a forgiveness to have happen in heaven at the same time. Not because of the pastor's person, but he is the instrument of God in doing that. This power works through the administration of the means of grace, the gospel when preached, the baptism, the Lord's Supper, and especially in absolution, where the pastor forgives sins in the stead and by the command of Christ to each one personally. Whenever sinners are contrite and fear the wrath of God, the pastor is to absolve them of their sins and comfort them with the gospel. When sinners are contrite, it is the duty of the preacher to comfort with the gospel and not to keep on threatening with the law. Since this work of forgiving sins is the proper work of God, it is also the proper work of the minister. While the gospel is simple, and the false doctrines and sins are often more complex and demand more space, the gospel should always have priority as the proper work of the pastor. The real goal of the ministry is that sinners may hear the gospel about Christ, who fulfilled the law for us, atoned our sins, was raised for our justification, and ascended to heaven to be our advocate at the right hand of God. You are given the power to deliver the forgiveness won by Christ on the cross through the means of grace. You are given authority to baptize children so they might become children of God also. You are given the authority to absolve repentant sinners of their sins and open up heaven to them. You are given the authority to administer the Lord's Supper and thereby to give the true body and blood of our Lord and Savior to sinners. This is the gospel that also saves you. You will be tempted to sin, also as a pastor, and you will also sin. So you will need the gospel as much as the flock you are watching. Even Luther said as one of his last words, after having taught the true gospel for many years, "Wir sind Bettler, das ist wahr," in German. We are beggars, that is true. Even a teacher of the gospel will to his end be a beggar, and you will need to repent daily of your sins. You will need to fight against pride and self-righteousness. The devil will do what he can to attack you, and even more when you are a pastor. If he cannot get you to stop warning the flock, he will try something else. He might attack you by tempting you to pride in the fact that you have kept his word and has not compromised. Even this pride is a sin that you will need to repent of. But whenever the law shows you your sins in the ministry, remember that God wants to save and forgive you. You need to live by the same gospel as those whom you are to preach the word to. And the gospel should lead you to love Christ who called you to the ministry. So you keep teaching his word faithfully, not only out of fear, but also out of love for him who forgave you all your sins. And when you do keep preaching and teaching faithfully, you will also be rewarded by God. As Paul says in 1 Corinthians 3, "Now if anyone builds on the foundation with gold, silver, precious stones, wood, hay, straw, each one's work will become manifest, for the day will disclose it, because it will be revealed by fire, and the fire will test what sort of work each one has done. If the work that anyone has built on the foundation survives, he will receive a reward." Now this reward, of course, is not eternal life, which is received by faith alone. It is also not a reward that you, strictly speaking, deserve. Rather, the reward is given by grace, and it is promised so that you may know that whatever hardships and crosses you receive on earth on account of your faithfulness, God will reward you when you fulfill your duties in the office. We have learned today what the duties are that you are to fulfill as a pastor. You are to be a watchman sent by Christ to watch the house of God. You are to study the word of God diligently so you know when you are to warn against sins and false teaching. And you are to warn against wickedness and false doctrine without considering the consequences for yourself. This is the alien work of the ministry, but it is necessary and will take a lot of time and effort in this godless world. If you do this and they will not hear, you are without guilt. If you don't do it, their blood is on your hand. You are also to comfort with the gospel and the absolving key by which you absolve people from their sins. This is the proper work of the ministry. You should never forget this, even when warning against sins and false teaching take up a lot of time and worry. All this serves the gospel, and you should always listen to the gospel yourself and preach it also to your flock so that they may be comforted when they repent of their sins. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen.